we'll speak and we will discuss about raising money and how we can support growth of great ideas, great technology through investors, on what, how to do it, when to do it, what are the struggles and the milestones that are important. So maybe first, can you all introduce yourself shortly on what you're doing and your company before we go into tough questions? Emily, yes.
Hi, I'm Emily Liprust. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Twist Bioscience. Twist, we make DNA from scratch. So you go on our website, you tell us the gene you want, we make it and we ship it. And we've developed a new technology based on silicon where we can do DNA faster, cheaper, and better. So usually it's 2 out of 3, and with us it's all 3.
Hi, my name's Ned David. I'm a biochemist. I've been founding biotech companies for about 18 years. A few went public, sold two of them, two FDA-approved drugs on the market. And what I've been doing for the last 5 years, Unity, is we're making drugs that extend health span, which is the duration of time you live free of chronic diseases of aging.
Hi, I'm Ron. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Aerobotics. We do completely automated drones. The company's been around for 2 years, 100 employees.
So you raised net, I think, $1.5 billion in your complete life. Emily, more than $130 million. Ryan, $30 million. It's a lot of money. How did you choose the volume and how much you were going to raise? What was the process in order to do that, and how did you take the decision? Did it come from you, from your investors? How did you do it?
Well, I think everything starts from an idea, right? And it really depends what kind of idea you have, how feasible it is, how crazy it is. Usually the more feasible it is, the less money you need. In my case, it was a pretty significant step forward in technology. So I had zero proof for what I was about to do. And from my experience, usually you need to find the right investors. I mean, that's the key point for me, finding the right investors that like to invest in specific things like that, where you just have a dream and you can convince them that you have the capacity to execute on it. Then once this dialogue starts, then I think that the level of reference of how much money you raise is pretty much set. My first round was $5 million, and usually that's where you would end up with your round A when you have no real proof of concept yet. That's my take on it.
Yeah, so when we started, me and my two co-founders, so they developed the idea for the technology, and we thought that we needed around 8 million to show the first proof point, and that's what you need, is have a clear understanding of how much money you need to demonstrate that the thesis of the business will work. And so you need to make sure that you have enough money until the next value creation point. And so in our case, same as you, we just had an idea and no demonstration. However, our business is quite hardware intensive, and so we thought that we needed around 8 to 9 to get there. And once we got to that proof point, we raised a second round to build the prototype. And again, the thought process was, how much do we need to build that prototype, knowing that you always have problem, and so you have to take that into account. And so that you not only have the money to do the work, but also solve the problems that you will have. And so that's what we've done consistently.
So I'll give 3 different answers for 3 different companies, because then they're radically different. So my first company, when I founded it in grad school, this was back in 1998. So I didn't know what I was doing. Okay, I was a little kid. And I went to the VCs, showed them a cool idea, and I did the wrong thing, which was they said, oh, just take $5 million for nothing in particular, for a very low valuation, effectively transferring ownership from myself to other people. And, you know, I'd never done this before, so I thought, awesome, money. And needless to say, that company, when we sold it, 7 years later, I owned a tiny, tiny little piece of it. Because not only was it so dilutive at the beginning, but that pattern of the venture capitalists controlling the company persisted throughout the entire life of the company through transaction. Anyway, I don't work with those investors anymore. Another company that exists at the opposite extreme, so that first company was called Cyrix. My third company, which is called Kythera, we realized that the next moment that Emily was referring to, like of value creation, was only $1 million in the future. And so what we did was something pretty wild. 2/3 of that first round was us, the founders, and 1/3 was from the VCs to legitimize the price, effectively causing the founders to own almost half the company, you know, right out of the gate, a phenomenon that persisted up and until we sold the company for $2.1 billion last year. And so it was like, you know, that's like the opposite of my first experience. And in many ways, it was informed by the mistakes made on the first experience because I was so traumatized by like how clueless I was. And then the current project, Unity, this was a company that's a really wild idea that basically 5 years ago when we started it, no one believed it was possible because like Ryan over here, there was... we had no evidence it was possible, or it was incredibly thin. So I showed the project to a bunch of investors. They all politely told me to go away. And then my tried and true investor, Arch, when Emily and I share a co-investor, said, okay, yes, you have no evidence, but we'll give you the first $1 million to try to prove this. And we were, with our $1 million, we were able to eke out just the littlest bit of evidence that it was true. And we didn't actually, they didn't buy stock for the $1 million. It was a loan. And the loan was built to convert into stock at a future moment once we had proof. You may say, well, why would someone ever loan you money just so that you could sell them stock at a higher price, which is basically what that was. It's because they're awesome investors and they think about the long game and they want to keep you in their ecosystem.
Really cool. I must say I had the same experience in my first company that I created when I was 22, and we raised our first million of euros, not knowing how much we needed. So that was a real question for me as well. Then the question that you started to tackle, but it's the question of valuation. You have great idea, you know that you need money. How do you discuss your valuation, or how do you set the price of your company when you discuss with your investors?
I guess every question here is very different for different entrepreneurs. For me, and I'm sorry to be on your opposite side maybe, but for me it was never about equity. I really didn't care. To date, I don't really care about the equity I have in the company. I mean, I care, but it's not why I'm there. I'm there because to do something I love doing, with people I love doing it with. And obviously, after being a several times successful entrepreneur, raising money is easier because you've already been there, done that. So the first step, I mean, if people here are looking into raising money for the first time, you're nobody. Nobody knows who you are. You have the spark in your eyes, maybe, and people might believe in you or not. For me, I have a lot of appreciation for the VCs who decided to bet on me. Because I had zero experience, nobody knew me, and all I had was this crazy idea, and they were willing to bet on me for it. So equity was never a very important thing for me. But again, I think to your question, valuation usually comes very tied into to the amount of money raised. Usually it would be somewhere between 15 and 25%. At least where I raise money in Silicon Valley, that's kind of the name of the game. So I didn't really argue too much. And, you know, maybe in a couple of years I'll understand it was a mistake and I'll finish, you know, whatever the future holds for my company, I'll, you know, at the end I'll say, oh no, I was left with too little. And another thing to add to that point, I was much more concerned about the equity my team has. We are, I think, one of the companies that gave a significant amount of options to our employees. It was important for us to create this team atmosphere. So sorry for the answer, but it wasn't really relevant for us.
I just wanted to clarify something. So focusing on equity is not a focus on wealth or money. So what I learned from a series of investors is that the ones that were most sadistic from an equity taking standpoint, it was predictive of their assessment of, it was sort of a diagnostic of what kind of people they were over time. So, you know, I think that simply viewing it as like how much wealth I'm going to retain is not necessarily the right lens.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, it's all about the passion. We do it to save the world in each our own different ways. But to go back to your question about the valuation, you know, it's market. Right, so you go out, you raise money, and your first term sheet, you get a valuation, and the more term sheets you get, the higher the valuation goes. And after two or three or four term sheets, you get a sense of what the market says the value is. And there's nothing better to get the valuation higher than multiple term sheets. And so at the end of the day, it depends what have you accomplished in your last round at that valuation inflection. Once you have that new, the first prototype, the valuation goes up. You have the first customer, the valuation goes up. The first revenue, the first profitable revenue, every time that valuation goes up. And the market is, you know, somewhat rational in the end, when enough people look at it, you get the true valuations. Sometimes it's not what you want. Sometimes it's better than you thought. I think in the end it's never good enough. I think for entrepreneur we always want to get the best possible for the existing investors and employees. But at the end of the day, to me, it's the market speaks.
So I have a somewhat unusual view on this. So, they're unrelated. It's two ideas. So first is that, particularly when you're working on something that's way out there, that could be worth a tremendous amount, but more likely than not is destined to fail. How do you describe value to it? And so, rather than arguing with venture capitalists about what it's worth, I found an alternative strategy, which is you basically, from an ownership point of view, make them co-founders.
And what do you mean?
So there are two ways to do that. You actually issue them a bunch of common so that they literally have aligned economic incentives with you, or you do a small round at the beginning in which you have a deliberately low pre-money valuation so they buy in along with the founders. The side effect of this is that every subsequent decision around valuation is, rather than it being this other side of the table thing, they suddenly are behaving in every transactional angle the way you want to behave. And it's a powerful idea symbolically, just for fraternity. So everybody's really pulling in the same direction. But the side effect is you find your VCs arguing for higher valuations because they acquired stock inexpensively. That's a sort of unusual strategy, but if it's one that I've used on multiple companies now, and it's something that's worked well with Arch because they're a company, they're a fund that likes to think of themselves as co-founders. Secondly, I think you have to be very careful with not letting your valuation get away from you. So I've had one of my companies where the valuation got too high, and it was way out in front of where we were, and it basically crushed the company because we couldn't raise money on any set of deal terms that anyone would say yes to because it would have crushed their ownership because we stumbled. And so now, you know, even if you do all the little tricks so that your valuation is high, I would caution everyone to like be cool. Like, don't push it too hard, you know, because, you know, it'll come back to bite you the moment you stumble. And so I think, you know, being mellow about it is a good idea.
Yeah, I definitely agree. So if I was to sum up, it's about market valuation. And I do agree it's really hard to find a true value on a project and ideas that is subject to failure, is subject to a market that sometimes doesn't even exist yet. And going on that, on the experience you had with your first VCs, I think it's a combination of ownership and terms as well. And what are the really important terms you look in your term sheets and conditions that are key for you as an entrepreneur when you take money from VCs or investors?
The focus for me was always on the investor himself. And to touch on your point, I agree that this is a person that is either going to torment you and make your life living hell, or be your best friend. And it's very hard to understand from the entrepreneur's side who you're standing with. So what I do usually is I spend a lot of time understanding who the person that is actually going to be on my board, spending time with him, talking to his other CEOs. And I was lucky enough with my investors to create this vibe where we're a team. So, I mean, obviously there's the legal terms of the term sheet and they're important, and, you know, I usually let the lawyers deal with that because, you know, it's pretty standard, I think. If something is out of the scope of what's usually, or, you know, what's acceptable, then they'll give you a red flag and say, you need to watch this. Then you have a discussion and you sort it out, which is also, by the way, is very educational towards how the relationship is going to look down the line. The negotiation with the VC or the investor at the first step of, you know, this is a good, it's a good trial. So as you said, if you get several term sheets, it's a good test to try and negotiate with the VC and see who the person is through that. But again, I think the most important thing is who the person is. And, you know, when shit hits the fan, and it always does. I mean, at some point, it always does. Yeah. It always happens at some point. You're going to hit that rock. You're going to fall. You're going to get punched. You're going to take the air out of your... It's going to happen. And at that point, will you pick up the phone and call your investors and give them bad news? Or will you pick up the phone and call your investors and have them help you? That was the key point for me.
I think I totally agree. It's all about the person. Yes, the investor brings money, and that's key. But they bring with them a lot of added value, like network and experience, and having had the good experience, the bad experience. And so the terms are important, but even more important, the quality of the investors is key. And sometimes it's better to take worse term on and lower valuation, but for a better investors. And overall, there are, you know, several categories of terms. There's the upside term, so when the company is massively successful, who gets the money? And there's the downside term, in case there's a problem, what happens? And then there are the control terms, who makes the decision. And it is written in the document, but, you know, at the end of the day, especially in the control terms, you need to have a good relationship with your investors. You know, at the board, we never voted. We've been in business 3.5 years. I don't remember a time we voted. At some point, for an entire year, I think we even were 6 on the board, right? There was no tiebreaker, but when you start having to vote, you have other problems. So yes, you can optimize all those terms, but for me, the one that I optimize the most is the upside terms, like the liquidation preferences. That's the one where is the most important for me and the employees.
I'll just echo what Ren said. you learn who you're dealing with through the negotiation, and it's almost like a Rorschach test for the person's soul. And the number of times I've seen seemingly nice people in a normal interaction become unnice people when discussing deal terms, then it turns out they're not nice people when the shit does in fact hit the fan. So I just want to echo what you said. It's like dating, but under like super high stress. Okay. Yeah.
It's like dating and you can't divorce.
Yeah. With a market strategy. So what appears to be really important, and I have exactly the same feeling, is the people you are working with. You started to address that question, but I think there is two kind of stuff. How did you find your investors? Who did you decide to pitch? What was your strategy to find the right VC for you?
In my case, so we're based in Israel. It's a very different VC dynamic in Israel and outside of Israel. There's several VCs in Israel that are doing very well. But for what we were trying to do, I very quickly understood that the chances of us getting financed in Israel are very low. Because the idea was really out there and we had no proof. So, you know, at some point I said, I want to play in the NBA. I need to go to the United States, where the metaphorical NBA for VCs is, I guess, Silicon Valley. And luckily enough, I met, there's this accelerator there called UpWest Labs, which brings Israeli startups to Silicon Valley. And so to answer your question, it was very important because I needed to learn to speak the language and understand the culture, which I guess is very different. I saw it was very different between Israel and Silicon Valley. I'm sure
it is from France. I think it's even worse, the difference between France and Silicon Valley.
I guess every like investor hub, whether it's in Asia or Europe or the United States, is very different, and you need to learn the rules. There's some specific rules to the game that you need to learn, because at first I remember I came with this projection of, you know, the company doing $20-30 million a year in revenue. I was like, this is awesome. Like, and people were like, that's it? If you're not planning on building a $1 billion company, why are you talking to us? I mean, it's like a very different game, and you need to understand that and find the people that are relevant to the game that you want to play. If you want to play blackjack, that's fine. If you want to play roulette, then you need to go to the people who are willing to take the high bets and play roulette. So I spent a lot of time trying to research the VCs and look into their portfolio and see who are the guys who are betting on, you know, the specific kind of niche I was going to. So I was doing hardware, and you know, most of the Silicon Valley VCs don't want to touch it, but some are. And you know, at some cases it's easier, because you know, instead of talking to 50, you have 7 that you can talk to because they're interested in doing crazy shit. So I just kind of approached them, and I was lucky enough to meet the CEO of Waze, which is also an Israeli in Silicon Valley. He became our sponsor, and eventually the funds that invested in Aerobotics, Blue Run Ventures, and Charles River Ventures are both connected to Noam, which is who's the CEO of Waze. And Blue Run Ventures was actually the first investor in Waze. So once you find that sponsor and you know, to make that link, I think it makes it much easier.
Yeah, I think I'd like to echo what Ran said. The key is to do the research on the investors, because they have a specific field in which they invest. So in my field, some invest in therapeutics, some invest in diagnostics, some invest in tools, some invest in medtech. And if you go, so we're a tools company, if we go pitch to someone that only does medtech, you know, you're just wasting your time. So doing research is key, and then you just have to get in front of them. And what's great about investors is that they are not shy about telling you the 5 or 10 or 100 reasons why your idea is a bad idea and why it won't work. And then you need to be a quick study, like you said. Well, revenue is too small. All right, is the company over, or do I need to think of a different model where the revenue is bigger? So as you get that feedback, you need to refine the business plan and the thesis of the business and of the company, and you know, get out there and pitch. The key is to get a really warm introduction. If you send an email to an investor, there's just zero chance that that you'll get an investment. You need to be recommended by someone that knows them and that is trusted by them, and that person needs to know you and trust you. So I'm lucky that I live in the Silicon Valley, and there is quite a bit of capital. But in the end, the investor that was the first to make the decision is in Chicago, right? And so you never know where the investment will come from. We have investors from France, from Singapore, from Russia, from China, from Chicago, Oslo, from Silicon Valley. But yeah, you need to get out there and make sure that you have your ears open for feedback, because it can be brutal, especially at the beginning. But if you act on the feedback, then the story and the company gets better.
So in the field I work in, it's simpler because there's simply so few venture capitalists that invest in high-risk biology, meaning, you know, fundamental questions about, is the biology going to do the thing you want to do? Not technology, just, or you got the biology right or wrong. And but when I started, you know, so many years ago, I met through an introduction my first investors, which was through my graduate work. And it was a very random, you know, interaction that didn't end well, as I described earlier. But it was when I found this one guy, Bob Nelson, who is one of Emily and I share Bob, who's just this wonderful, playful, spiritual dreamer guy, who's one of who I've now invested. He's been investing in my companies for 12 years, and you know, I don't know what I would do without him. Okay, but I, you know, so I guess how is that actionable for people in the audience? It's find this person that you connect with in this really deep way, who you can laugh with, and it's okay to share your frailties and your strengths, and that when you find that person and you feel safe with them, just, you know, stick with them. But you're not going to find it in the first one or two, so you have to kiss a lot of frogs.
I love the metaphor. When you're CEO of a company, you have a lot of topics, and you are working on your technology, on your sales, on your team, how to get the best team. How do you dedicate yourself, and how do you organize yourself when you start deciding that you're going to fundraise? What do you do it like full time in a very short schedule? How do you do that, and what advice would you give to a young CEO who wants to start his company on how to organize himself on the topic?
I think one of the biggest challenges a CEO has is what I call the CEO position. For me, the best metaphor is like being a DJ. You're standing on this giant console, and you know, there's treble and bass and guitars and the beat. And every day I come into work and I try to listen to the music and what's going on, and every day something needs to change. You need to up the treble, you need to down the bass, and before going on a fundraise, it's pretty similar. You know that one component is gonna be dropped down, and you need to prepare yourself. So everybody on my team, down to our newest employees and the most senior management, they know that now comes the phase where Ron needs to disappear, especially because, you know, we're in Israel and we usually fundraise outside of Israel. And it's a lengthy process, and you need to prepare yourself for it mentally on one hand, because it's demanding. As you said, it's not easy to come into a person with your dream and have it crushed 10 times out of 10 most of the time. And you know, get back, get your head straight, and then go at it again. And when you do that, for me at least, I need to be completely focused on that. So obviously when you're raising your seed, there's no company to take care of, so just go and get it done. when you're doing your A, there's something going on, so you need to make sure you know that's still running properly. And the further you go into future rounds, so now there's 100 people working in my team, so leaving the company for an extended period of time has serious ramifications. So I need to make sure that you know my senior management and my partners know that, okay, now I'm leaving, and they need to take care of the stuff that needs to be taken care of on a day-to-day basis so I can focus and be clear-headed about the round. Because at least for me, it's very difficult to do that and be able to actually run the operation in the company. So I think a strong CEO, a COO, is something that's very important to have at that point.
So I have a slightly different strategy for fundraising. When people ask me when is the best time to raise money, my answer is always today. So every day I do fundraising. We close our last round, I think January 8th, January 9th, you know, I was fundraising. And my view of fundraising is more about developing relationship with investors. And so I try to speak to as many investors as possible, even if I'm not raising a round, especially when I'm not raising a round, because I've never met someone that gave me a check the first time I met them. And so it's a process. It takes a long time. And so I try to get in front of investors as often as possible, just to present the company and get feedback of you know, what they think is good, what they'd like to see. And sometimes 2 years later, when I am fundraising, for real raising a fund, then they are ready because they have heard the story for a while. They've met me or my team several times. Maybe 2 years ago they thought there was no way we were going to make it, and we do. And so then you gain credibility, so you can demonstrate credibility. And so when time comes to actually put a round together, it's a little bit easier because you've already lined up those relationships. But so it is a time commitment. The good news, I guess, in that point of view is it's actually it takes time. There's a lot of empty time. So you set a meeting. All right, so now you have to wait 2 weeks. And in 2 weeks you have a 1 hour meeting. And then you have to wait another week to get the feedback. And then it's another 2 or 3 weeks to set up the next meeting. So when it can feel excruciating if you're really in the hard fundraising mode. But when you are constantly trying to maintain those relationship, I think it can fit in quite well with the rest of the work that has to be done at the company. And then at the end, when things accelerate, you need to close around, then yes, you have to go full speed. And having a strong CEO is very, very important. And the idea is, if you're doing your job right as a CEO, you can be off for a while. The company knows what to do. If everybody has to check with you every day and you have to make all the decisions, you're not set up for success. So having a strong management team helps you when really the last months you have to put the pedal to the metal and get everything done.
So as Emily was mentioning, fundraising, at least in my life, is lumpy. So there's this big, intense effort of meeting people, and then there's a bunch of time when nothing happens, then there's more follow-up, then not very much happens. And so I always say to anybody who's doing this, take the amount of time you think it will take to raise money and assume it's going to be at least 3 times longer, at least, and it could be 4. And so just imagine that that's what your life is going to be like, and think about how do you finance the company and operate during that 4x longer than you thought. The next thing about money raising, it's not just the CEO's time that gets sucked away. I mean, you lose, because a lot of people want to see the whole senior team, so it's actually kind of worse than just the CEO going, because you know, a really good management team can function CEO minus for a while because you have a really good goals system and you've got good communication system, but it can't function management team minus. And so that's the part that's almost more destructive than CEO absence, is like, you know, all of your C-suite people. like out there on the road. So you just have to be really protective of them and try to absorb as much of it as you can so you don't really dent your company.
Yeah, I think it was one of the biggest things during due diligence to try to take the most on you and just let your team work. It's really important. Speaking of timing, it always takes longer than you expect, and it has always been the case in my case. How do you fix it? It's a pretty continuous process, but when do you decide to accelerate it? And when you pass a milestone, when you expect to pass a milestone in the coming weeks or months, when is the right moment for you to raise? It's when you see that you're going to be out of money in 9 months. For you, how do you choose the timeline?
This was said before, and I can echo that. It said, I usually say, okay, what is our biggest step forward over the next year or so where we are still funded? What is that moment where we can say, wow, this now is really a big step forward for us to go out and say we've accomplished that? Because as you said, one of the most important things with investors is building the relationship and the trust that could actually give them the feeling that you're executing and you're trustworthy and your predictions are somewhat realistic. So for us, it's a bit harder because for two reasons, we're in Israel. So we don't have the luxury of having investors come in every day to see what we're up to and, you know, check it out. And then, because obviously that's very important. If someone can come in and then 2 months later come in again and see the progress, and then 6 months later come in and see the progress, then you're really building the trust that, you know, the team is performing well. We don't have that. On top of that, we're doing hardware. So people see our video, but they don't really get the size of this thing and what it does, so they really have to see it for themselves. So it's a bit harder for us. But back to the question, I usually say, okay, this is the amount of money I think I need to raise to get to the next milestone. What are the points I really want to be able to proof case to our next investor? If the first stage is, let's, you know, create a proof of concept that actually works, okay, so this is how much money we need. And then the next step is actually building an MVP, and that's the next milestone. And then proofing first sales and operations and deployment, and then next step is showing a pipeline and being able to execute on sales. So, and then you also have this agenda around your round, which I think is important, because for every round we've done, there's been a theme. First round was, you know, proving the technology. Second round was building a product. Now the third round that we're about to go on is showing that our product brings value, the technology works, and people actually want to buy it. And then you have this agenda coming up to the stage where you're now raising fund for growth and saying, you know, the basics are here, everything is working. Now we need money because we need to expand. And you have your proof points set up that the guy sitting in front of you understands that, okay, these guys have hit all these, now they need money to grow, and that's where I want to come in.
Yeah, it's about retiring the risks. When the investors look at what are the market risk, is the market there? What is the technology risk? Will it work? And then what's the the people risk, the management risk, and the can they bring in the people to do the work, and can they manage the business? And initially, in a startup, usually you're working on the technology risk, so that's why you get the proof of concept and the prototype. And so it's knowing when to raise is a little bit in the eye of the beholder, but you know when not to raise, right? If you don't raise the day before you turn on the machine and, you know, see if it works, right? Because you just give the value to someone else. So you wait until you've demonstrated that, oh yeah, boom, it works, now you're more valuable. Typically it's when major risks are being retired. Typically it's technology risk and then management risk, and then at the end you have the technology, like you said, all right, now we are selling, and you have that moment of, are people going to buy the product? And then they buy, and then you have that second moment about, can I scale? Because now everybody wants to buy. Then you need to scale and reach operation maturation. And the key, therefore, is to know who is going to be your next investor. So, for instance, where we are now in our commercial ramp, my next investor is not going to be a VC. My next investor is going to be a growth investor. And they have a slightly different goal. They, in terms of financial return. And so you have to start lining things up. So as you anticipate that you'll be at the commercialization phase, that you start putting in place the relationship so that when the commercialization is successful and you really need to grow, the relationships are there. So you have to really be strategic and think in advance, where do you want to go and what you're going to prove, and then what's the next step. But it's basically when you have a big risk going away that's when you raise money.
So it's sort of common sense that you raise to the enough money beyond the next value creating moment, and sometimes that's easy to figure out. So Kythera, the first moment was $1 million away, the second moment was $30 million away, and the third moment was another $50 million after that. And so we raised it in those chunks. The challenge, however, when you work on things that are big and transformational, is you can measure certain distances of spend, but you're not 100% sure that they're going to work. So I think an interesting example is SpaceX. So they had enough money for 3 launches, okay? And the first 2 blew up, okay? And, needless to say, it worked out pretty well. Now they're going to Mars, okay? And so, but that was a company, it was more complicated because Elon Musk was, self-financing a lot of it. But it was a situation where, even the idea was that you had to finance a few tries to get one to work, to prove it's going to work. And so sometimes it's not as cut and dry that you can spend $50 or $100 million and flip the data card and be good to go. You might have to choose essentially in advance to know that you're going to fund multiple rocket launches and that one's going to be okay. And in my experience, that's the way you have to do biology. And it's worked out. But it's not, I wish it were as cut and dry as, we're going to build this prototype and we're good to go.
Yeah. Emily, in what you said, there were 2 really interesting topics that I think every entrepreneur want to address. It's, do you choose your investors when you are picking them up and pitching them on their capability to follow you through your company history? Or we know that some investors are focused on seed, some are focused on Series A, some are focused on Series B. Other ones try to be at every step of the process. Is it an important parameter for you that you will stay with the same guys that will follow you round after round, or you just focus on who has the expertise on this first step of your company? It's my first question. The second question is about investors' expectations on exits. You have a brilliant idea, you want to change the world. Investors want to, but they have limited partners, they have exit strategies. How do you discuss that, and how do you manage that as entrepreneurs with long-term vision versus investor vision on the exit strategies?
So to answer the first question, everybody wants to be rich and young and beautiful and single. But in all reality, you choose your investor, hopefully that on that scale of metaphor, you want him to be able to take you all the way and do all the rounds that you're about to do, but then on the other hand, nobody does that almost. And you know, you want to create the personal relationship, so usually at first you'll go to smaller funds that have the capacity to actually invest in who you are and help you out, as opposed to the big funds that, you know, have 15 partners and you need to meet half of them and just to decide if they're good for you or not. So I think first step is you know, get the right person on board. Then think about, you know, there's so much things you can't anticipate. You know, you don't know where the company is going to go. You don't know where the market is going to go. But having someone on board that has your back and can also be on your team all of a sudden, and he knows he's playing both sides. He knows the VC world, and he can help you later on approach the appropriate people. And another very important thing is that if your investors keep backing you up, that's a very, very strong statement towards your future investors, because they know you, and obviously they all have very good relationships with the other VCs, and if they're still in the game, that's a very good sign for other investors to come and join. And usually, from my experience, they try and bring in people that, you know, from later stages that they trust. So if the first round, if the first VC that comes in just does seed and A, then they usually have relationships with VCs that do B, C, and growth, and they'll try to bring them along because they've been working together for a long while. So that usually happens naturally. For the second question, what was that? Sorry.
Exit strategy. Of VCs.
I have to say, none of my investors ever talk to me about it. I know they're thinking about it, and you know, I trust them that they're looking at the game plan, looking at the company, looking at where we're going. I know that in the end, you know, that's the end goal of an investor, but I leave it up to them. I think that once they decide to invest, they can see the exit strategy happening somewhere along the line, so I don't really have discussions about that with them.
So the first question was?
The focus of the VCs.
I think I agree with Ron that it's rare where you get a VC that can do everything. And the key is to take a VC an investor that's right for that round. So if you do a Series A and it's someone that does seed, that's a red flag, because when you need the Series B, they won't be able to participate. So as long as you have investors that are clear that, yeah, they do that kind of round, even if they may not be able to lead or participate greatly at future round, I think it's okay, as long as you know in advance. Although it's good that for each round to be able to say, and by the way, all my current investors are going to participate. I think that's a very important sign for the incoming investor. But you know, there are times where if you do a crossover round that's, you know, just before the IPO and it's you know, a $50 or $100 million round, the VCs that maybe supported you at the beginning may not be set up for that. And so you can't expect them necessarily to participate fully. And so in talking to investors, it's important to understand at the first round, not only how much are they going to invest, but also how much are they reserving for you for the next round. So it's I always make sure that I ask that, and what's your reserve question? That way you know what you can expect at the next round. And so if the information is there, I think you can manage it. As far as the exit, I always found it weird that people were asking me, what's the exit? And I'm like, we haven't even started. What are we talking about? But I think it makes sense to know what you're getting into. Because all kind of exit are great and possible. So IPO is fantastic, but you can also have a business model where you know it would be a sale to another company. And if that's the case, maybe you only build the technology and you don't build a commercial team because you know that it will be sold to someone else that will use their commercial team, and that can be a successful exit too. Or it could be having a private equity firm come in to buy out the existing investor. So all is possible, all can make sense, as long as it's clear in advance with the investor what are the expectations, because you don't want to be in that situation where they think that it's going to be a quick sell and you're thinking IPO, or vice versa, you think, oh, I'm just sure the technology works and then boom, I'm out. And they think that, no, you're going to go all the way to commercialization. So after I've had the discussion a few times, now I appreciate why it's important to actually have the talk, so that you're not surprised and the expectations are aligned.
So of the two questions, the first one, I'll just echo what's already been said, which is that I like my investors to be able to both be VCs and in a limited way buy in the IPO. It's good signaling optics, that's one thing, but I think more importantly, if they can't buy in the IPO, they wind up with non-aligned incentives, all right? And so you can see weird behavior that you just don't want. And even if it's a small symbolic participation, it's good. Anyway, you guys have already kind of said that. I'll say something you guys definitely didn't say, okay, about exits. So with the exception of only one of my companies, where although what I'm about to say we held true there, but we never talk about exits ever, okay? So my view is the best companies are not sold, they are bought. And what does that cryptic Yoda-like remark mean? What it means is that I never think about building companies for exits. And by the way, that's the irony of this is that that's how you get the best exits, yeah, right? Because you're building a company to be awesome, not to be money-making or profit-making, shall I say. So, you know, if you dream of trying to build, say, in biotech, the next Amgen or the next Gilead, and you don't think about how I'm going to offload this to somebody at some, you know, prescripted moment in time, you know, who you hire, what you aspire to, how do you invest in the future, the complexion of your reality changes if that's your lens on the universe. And the bizarre side effect is, I think that's why my last company, you know, because we built it to be an independent company, and it was sold like it was an independent company, not one that was a captive for sale, like something at the farmer's market that's tied to a post that's going to be eaten for dinner.
Yeah.
I think what you're saying is very true. To add on it, I think generally there's two types of exits. One, someone buys you for the technology. Second, someone buys you because you're a kick-ass business. Obviously, the latter is the better situation to be in. And I completely agree with what you said. I mean, I want to build the best, most successful automated drone company in the world. And if I do that, then I'll be fine, either with exit or an IPO. So.
Yeah, I definitely agree, but some investors sometimes ask this question.
It's a totally fair question to ask, and in a sense, I'm deliberately giving this alternative lens just to be provocative. You know, now if you were to say that to certain investors, they would throw you out of the room, which you say, I'm not going to discuss that with you. They'd think you're an asshole, okay? But, you know,
sometimes.
Yeah, which is really good, yeah.
Yeah, you know, yeah, everyone's seen Silicon Valley. Yeah. Exactly right. But we're not going to quote that section right now. But my point is I think it's a more powerful idea, rather than telling people I refuse to discuss the exit with you because it's not awesome, okay? I think it's a more powerful idea just privately and with your team. And when you talk about, you know, your strategy, which is, you know, don't think about the exit, think about awesomeness.
We have 5 minutes left. If you were to give a last advice to the scientists, future entrepreneurs, or actual entrepreneurs in the room, what would it be?
In regards of in fundraising, I guess, not
yeah,
generally
yeah,
in
course,
life,
yeah.
Because I have a lot to say.
Oh, you
that.
Can, as well, if there is something really important you want
dating,
to share.
You know, yeah. most important thing I can say is find the right investor. And we've said that, we all said this, and I think that's the most important thing you can do. Just look into the person that you're about to go and climb Everest with. That's how you need to think about it. Is this person going to back me up? Is he going to be there for me when I'm tired, when I'm sick, when I'm not doing well? So important. So just focus your energy on deciding, you know, who you're bringing to the table.
I think it's a great advice. And initially you think, oh, I just need money, I'll take anybody. But actually, you should do what Rand says. So I have two advice. One is self-serving. What you should do is buy DNA, and we make the best DNA. Shameless plug. The second advice, which is the real advice, you should buy the book called Venture Deals by Bradfeld. I make no money on it, but it is the best book. It's written by a VC, and at every stage of fundraising, he explains the process, how a VC or the investor think about it. They go through the terms, which one you can expect, which one you cannot expect, and the rationale to negotiate. It's my Bible. I've read it 10 times, and I could not have raised the $130 million that I did without knowing that book backward and forward. So if I can give an advice, that's just buy the book. It's expensive. I think it's $40, but it's the best money you will ever spend after buying some DNA.
So this is going to sound, again, Yoda-like, but you can apply it to money raising. Listen to yourself. Now, what do I mean by that? When you talk to investors, or you can apply this in multiple places in your life, if there's this gnawing sense inside you, you know, where your brain says, oh, no, this is going to be totally cool. You know, so this person's a little scary and they said something super mean to me in the first meeting, but I'm sure it's not really reflective of their underlying character. If you have this feeling inside you that this does not seem right, it doesn't feel right, this person, this idea that's being proposed isn't correct, learn to listen to that voice. It's taken you a long way just to get to the idea, whatever technology it is you're building. You've been listening to this inner voice for decades at this point. And for some reason, like in my first company, I just decided to stop listening because I figured I was ignorant and I was in some new area. So of course I'm not going to listen to myself because I don't know anything. But that was wrong. I should have listened, but I didn't. And so it just took me getting kicked in the face a few times before I started noticing that, in fact, that inner voice actually is a lot smarter than you think it is. And listen to it, and to some extent, obey it.
Emily, Ran, Nats, thank you very much. It was really great to have this discussion with you. I hope you liked it. Thank you.